state to state or one district to another, and that is a teacher's fear. I'll start and get really strong, and then I've got to test this child when he comes back and he's not been with me for 6 months. I don't know what he's been learning. With common standards, they're all learning the same standards. The same standards from Common Core and Essential Standards. So we should know what they've learned by the time the test comes around in the spring. And that's comforting to know. College and career readiness, they need to be more than proficient. We have a new definition of proficient. What does it mean? In the past with the EOG, it meant once you crossed over from a 1 to a 2, and you cross that little line, that little thin line, to a 3, you're proficient. That's a very narrow definition of proficiency. So what it means to be proficient now is going to be all of those skills that we saw the graduate with. Being fluent with those skills and being able to problem solve and think and be creative communicators, all of that is going to raise the bar for proficiency. And then comparability. The states that have adopted the Common Core will be able to compare apples to apples, not apples to oranges. And then we have shared resources and economies of scale. We've already heard school districts, just in even Region 8 and across the state, saying, I understand that this district has already built an instructional calendar so that they know by the end of first quarter what should second graders have accomplished from the Essential Standards and Common Core. Because if we really all have the same standards, couldn't we share the same resources? Couldn't we build those lesson plans that we can share across the state and across our district and across our school? So that's something that's really helpful for teachers. And then, of course, economies of scale. We talk about cloud computing and the opportunities that that brings in the sense of technology or programs and those kinds of expenses that cost individual school districts or individual schools in some cases to purchase. But of course, economies of scale will help us with that. And then if you think about Common Core math, these are the four what you might call hallmarks of the Common Core math. And those of us who are math lovers and have been for many years know that we have been talking about this for a good 30 years. This is not new to us. We've been begging those worksheets to kind of go away and for kids to get down and dirty with the math and the thinking. For those AIG kids who close their book when we say, can you show me how that works? Can you think of another way to do it? Can you prove it to me? Those kids have the hardest time with this, because now we're saying, yes, you've got the answer, but is there, if I put a variable in there or if I put a new scenario in there, can you show me another way to solve it? This is what we've been talking about for years. So we as math educators are really excited about this. Problem solving. It's all about problem solving. And the perseverance piece is the big piece. Not going to get to a quick answer now. There's no quick answer. We're going to have to really use our skills. We have to figure out which operation to use. The teacher's not going to say this is a division day. Today we're doing division. We've got to figure out which operations and which methods are going to be best to use. And really then do that reasoning to really think abstractly, to attend to the precision, because precision is still critical and important, to use the right tools, to choose the right tools and when to use them, and then to construct those arguments and critique, to have that discussion in the classroom. This is the way I solved it, and this is the answer I got, but you got a different answer. How are we going to decide which answer is correct and which method was the most efficient? So those are the pieces that we're asking students to embrace and to persevere with. Do you have a question?
When's that textbook adoption coming on?
Textbook adoption is an interesting discussion right now, because we have no idea if textbooks will look anything like they look right now in schools. Because the traditional textbook that we're used to, the two-page spread, is not going to meet our needs.
I've seen some big changes at the secondary level, but I really haven't seen this contextualized problem solving thing at the elementary level. So
right.
I'm curious if you're seeing any of that kind of work coming from publishers yet or not.
There have been in the past a couple of those outliers out there that some brave school districts have been willing to test the waters in. I won't call any names, but one in particular has no answer, and the teacher guy with no answers, because we've got to figure that out too, which is the best way to solve the problem. But those are fewer because teachers want to know the answers before they teach. I need to know what's in the back of the book. But moving away from that is going to be a publisher's challenge, because teachers decide really by and large what they're going to vote for in their district or what they're wanting to see.
So there is a year or there is not a year set for math adoption this time?
We were traditionally on a five-year cycle for textbook adoption, and the state has frozen textbook funds to districts for at least the last 2 years. There's been no funding. And I don't know when that funding will come back around, but I do know that as far as working with publishers, many publishers are now looking at ebooks, not necessarily what we traditionally have used as textbooks, and more interactive web-based things. I will, if you ever get a chance when you're doing your late night surfing, if you'll just Google Dan Myers' math class needs a makeover, he addresses the textbook issue. The gentleman's name, he's a high school math teacher in California. He's been featured on Good Morning America. His name is Dan Meyer, and it's a TED Talk series called Math Class Needs a Makeover. It'll take you about 11 minutes to watch. But he talks about traditional textbooks versus this kind of problem solving and the challenge of taking what has traditionally been, did you get the right answer, into that higher level problem solving and how textbooks don't necessarily encourage that. I think it's well worth the time it takes to watch it. It's humorous, but it also really proves the point that we have to change our instruction and we have to change the kind of problems that we're giving students before this kind of math happens.
I will point out that several of our teachers are talking, certainly in this region, are talking about the fact that their school systems are having to look at adopting text anyway because they've lost the books. The books have more or less disappeared and been destroyed. So, because I'm getting questions all the time, tell me about this series, how's that series going to fit with the core curriculum, which one of these is most likely to still be available and still be what we want. So I think some of our teachers are facing that right now as we speak.
And the Common Core and some legs of the Common Core, shall we say, are right now developing repositories of lessons aligned with the Common Core standards by grade level. And teachers are working on these, colleges of education are working on these, math educators are working on these, so that there will be somewhere out there on the cloud, we hope, really strong lessons that might take my students a day or two to solve, really in depth, using all the power and skills that we have mathematically, and problem solving and critiquing. That's what we want to think about a different way. And we are in no, Shannon and I are in no way saying anything negative about textbooks. So we just want to make sure textbooks have been a strong foundation of education in this country for a long time. So we're not saying that. It's a challenge for publishers to meet these new standards and the way we're talking about the 21st century skills. But there are some of those wonderful opportunities being built on the horizon. And for math in particular, NCTM, there's so much on NCTM's website you could teach for years with what's up there, that National Common Core. So the National Council of Teachers of Mathematics. So these are the foundations of the Common Core for math, and it's very exciting. It's just really exciting. So as we think about coaching teachers and in your teacher preparation programs, we want them to ask this question first. What task can I as a teacher give to build student understanding rather than how can I explain it so they get it? So this is a little shift in the paradigm. I'm talking with teachers, we want to focus on these areas. Perseverance is one of the hardest ones. To get students to stick to it. And this modeling is about, how do you get students to model? How do you get students to model their thinking? So these five areas, these are great topics as you're working with teachers and teacher education programs. And as we coach teachers, this is what we'll focus on. So Jan's going to switch, we're going to switch gears now and talk about Common Core and English Language Arts for a few minutes.
And you are not allowed to tune out if you think, oh, I don't teach reading or literacy, because the Common Core state standards say, Common Core state standards for English Language Arts and literacy in social sciences, social studies, science, and technical subjects. It's about literacy. Literacy across the subject areas, about building academic vocabulary, about students being able to read and understand informational text. And so it really is about every single content area building literacy. This is a scary thing when people first say, wait a minute, I'm a high school biology teacher, how can I be responsible for ELA? But it takes talking to them and talking about building academic vocabulary. They're doing it anyway, but we've got to have more of an emphasis on it. And I'll give you an example from my own teaching. I was a high school social studies teacher, taught U.S. history and civics and economics. And looking back, I was probably very guilty of using, I taught Heidi in that class. You can tell all kinds of stories on me. But I was probably very guilty of using the word people very often. And yet, when you put students in a situation where they're reading text, they're not going to read people. They're going to read words like demographics and populace. Words that I might not have been explicitly using in class. And so it's about asking teachers to be very mindful that they are teaching academic vocabulary across the content areas. We're going to look at a couple of changes with this. These are just some big overview changes about how we will be teaching ELA. I'm going to go to this. There's four strands in Common Core for ELA: reading, writing, speaking and listening, and language. Underneath reading, there's a foundational skills piece that's specific to K-5. That's the way the standards are set up. It's very structured that way. And it really is about integrating literacy across all. And when we talk about literacy, it's about every kind of literacy you can imagine. You may have heard that the state board, well, the legislature first changed the renewal credits for teachers. That was adopted in this last session of the General Assembly. Teachers traditionally have had to have 15 credits to renew their teaching license in North Carolina. The General Assembly cut that to 7.5. The state board then just adopted a policy at the November meeting of what that 7.5 has to look like. And in the past, teachers have been getting a year of credit, one CEU, for every year of service, active service in the school system, and that's no longer true. To earn that 7.5, there's no credit for time served, I guess is what you could call it. But instead, they have to have at least one credit in their content area. If I'm an art teacher, I need at least one of those 7.5 credits to be in art. If I'm the health and physical education teacher, I need at least one to be in physical education and health. Then one of those credits has to be in literacy. Literacy is very broadly defined, though, because it's really about literacy in that content area. So that's two of those 7.5 credits are very defined. The rest of them are up to the teacher and the district initiatives, but those two are very clearly defined. We've done this in waves. You know, in the past, there used to be the technology credit, you had to get things like that. That's a given now. So it's specific to those two. Okay, there are anchor standards. The anchor standards span K-12. Those are standards, literacy standards that are K-12. Then when you get into grade level standards, and we've got links for all of this on the wiki, but I want to tell you what's not in there. And I think this is almost as important as what is in there. There's a great Doug Reeves video out there on the internet about his belief and the good things he sees about Common Core, but then he does a little caveat that kind of encompasses some of these. So these are intentional design limitations, things that were purposefully left out. The standards don't say how you should teach. There are some recommended best practices, but it leaves that idea of, you know, teachers tend to use their own strengths to impart what they need to or to facilitate that classroom. So it's not that prescriptive. I think when people first heard about Common Core, initially their reaction was, oh, this is straight from Washington. It's a federal movement. That's not true. This was initiated by state superintendents across the nation. Our state superintendent was one of those folks. And it does not delineate exactly how these standards should be taught. They're also not all-inclusive. A couple of things you won't find in there: cursive writing is never mentioned, handwriting is never mentioned. Okay, those things are not put out in there. Those are still state, district, school-type decisions. So don't start panicking if you can't find something in there. It's probably intentionally left out. Anything that goes beyond, they're minimal standards. So what's next is not in there. Interventions. I think right now, this past summer, we had summer institutes. We had teacher leadership teams there and district level leadership teams. This summer's institute is probably going to have a focus about, now that we know what the standards are, how do we differentiate with the standards? How do we differentiate for the gifted student, for the student with an IEP? How do we make these standards real in a classroom and alive? A couple of you have asked me about, we want to see some sample lessons. Joyce mentioned that some of those are being built. The ones you'll see out there right now, typically, if they're published somewhere on the internet, have been done by, a company has done it. But teachers are building those now. You know that the state, the General Assembly added 5 student days this year to the calendar. Students in North Carolina go 185 days this year versus the 180 we've had for so long. However, this 1 year, districts could apply for a waiver for anywhere from 0 to 5 of those additional days to be used for professional development to be ready to implement these standards. In Western North Carolina, some of our districts used 2, applied for a waiver for 2 days of PD, some used all 5. But a lot of our districts are working on writing lessons. They've worked on pacing guides, and now they're writing units and lessons to be ready to implement in August. The range of support for English language learners is not, or special needs students, is not clearly defined in there. And certainly not everything that they need to know would be in the standards. Again, they're minimal standards. This is going to be a big change.
I flipped by too quickly.
I will, sorry, and I will.
Yes. NSTAC, the National Secondary Transition Technical Assistance Center at UNC Charlotte, has been doing some work, and I just did a presentation with them looking at, because secondary transition for students with disabilities is really different than the Common Core standards. So they've been looking at developing lesson plans and how to align what those specific like IDEA mandates are with the Common Core standards. So those are coming out as well. So.
I think alignment between what we have been doing or what's mandated elsewhere versus this new set of standards is a topic really everywhere for how do we make that work. This next slide, I was going to say, I challenge you to go in any library, any media center library around, and just look at the spines or the book sets that you check out, because I know in my own school it would say a book set 4th grade only, or you go in high school and you see the Romeo and Juliet and it says 9th grade only, like get your hands off of it if you're a 10th grade teacher, and don't you judge it if you're in 8th grade. And I was teaching in middle school one time and we were having that battle with the high school about where did Diary of Anne Frank fit best in the curriculum. Common Core talks about, you know, we don't teach a book, a novel, a piece of literature. We teach a skill or a concept using that novel. And so this is going to be a big change for folks. Talks about using excerpts as well. But pigeonholing something that it has to be in this grade level, we need to re-examine that. Why is it in that grade level? Is it a skill that we're teaching, or are we still teaching in that grade level? Because we always have, and we had that when we were in high school at that grade level. So kind of getting us to look back at those critical questions about, you know, we need to start asking ourselves, why are we doing this? There may be a very valid reason it's in that grade level, but it may need to move. What you'll see with some of the new standards, the support documents like crosswalks and unpacking, will often tell you if something has moved, and very often it's moved to lower grade levels because the rigor has increased. There is a focus on text complexity. I won't read this to you, but I'll point out just a little bit. The piece about drawing evidence, students will be asked across all content areas to draw evidence. The recommendation is that about 70% of what a student reads would be informational text. They would still read fiction. Now, when we were doing this in the summer, some teachers panicked for a little bit, but remember, this is in the course of their day. So you're not just thinking about their English class or their reading class in elementary school. You're thinking in the course of their day, about 70% of what they read should be nonfiction. That's a point of emphasis. And doing that and making sure that we're being critical readers and drawing evidence. Teachers have to ask. We've often asked, how did reading this make you feel? How did you feel about it? So in addition maybe to how you felt, it's what evidence do you have for why the author, why do you think that's the author's tone or mood? Why do you think that's the theme? Now give me your evidence for that theme. So asking students to provide evidence. Writing is also a focus, really in 3 areas. Writing arguments, informative or explanatory text, and then narratives. We've been writing narratives. If you ask some elementary teachers, they will say that we've been stuck in the magic box land, you know. You're in a land and a little green elf jumps out, and we've written narratives like that for a long time. And if you think about the kind of writing that we all do in our careers and what most people do in their careers, no elves are jumping out of magic boxes. So it's really adding that level of rigor in writing too. Okay, these are a couple of things that are involved, but they're not explicit. It's kind of that hidden curriculum. But we have to make sure that we're teaching it, not just in our English classes, but being critical consumers of media. Students need to be able to evaluate websites, see if they're good sources. This is as low as elementary levels. Considering this perspective as others, of others, being able to argue and debate, collaborating, not just with the people in their classroom, but with people who may be miles and miles or a half a world away, becoming lifelong learners, and then academic self-awareness, that students can start being more reflective about their own learning and taking more ownership of their own learning. To condense all of that into just some bullets, if you're thinking about the new big ideas for elementary, more of an emphasis on those informational texts, strong sense of number sense and operations, deeper algebraic thinking by sixth grade. The algebra strand does start in kindergarten, but we want to see deeper thinking by sixth grade. Physical science concepts in earlier grades. Social studies are based around five concepts that go K-12, and so making sure that we focus on those, and then that critical consumer of media. These are big ideas for secondary. We're moving to a requirement for four social studies classes as a high school graduation requirement that has already passed. It has been three in the past, but our state board changed to taking the U.S. history course into two courses. There'll be a U.S. 1 and a U.S. 2 effective next year. That's going to be a challenge for some of our districts because we've lost teaching staff, and so they're not going to have any more people to do that, and yet they need to offer two courses. Literacy development standards across the 6-12 curriculum, a class for which Algebra 2 is a prerequisite of kind of upping that math rigor. You all can remember several years ago when our state said all students are going to graduate with Algebra 1 as a requirement. That wasn't so many years ago. And now the requirement will be a class above Algebra 2. And then world languages will be based on proficiency, not grade level or span. And if you look at that, it's really about students assessing where they are and teachers assessing where they are and proficiency levels. When I first saw that, I had to ask my friend who's a language teacher, does that mean that if I'm halfway through Spanish 1 and I'm proficient, I just move into Spanish 2? Because with my principal hat on, I start wondering, how do you do that with a schedule and how do you make that work with credits and all the practical things? And that's really not what it's about. It's about reaching levels of proficiency. It's not about scheduling. I still have more to learn about that, but it's about students reaching proficiency in language, not just achieving credits. The Acre website, yes.
Sure. They're vague, and vagueness gives us room and latitude, and that's nice. But what's happened in the past when that's been implemented is what I see is this emphasis on the elementary level of the ability to compose with a wide variety of media. Then we get to the secondary level, and the emphasis is on using the media and being effective consumers. And I don't see that bridge, which comes from the elementary level, that has that same requirement and expectation. And yet it's our middle level students and our high school students that are making significant use of the newer technologies. Is that going to be in here? I mean, we can assume all of that under the 21st century slides that you had up earlier, but there seems to need some traction here with the language that gets at this. Are we going to see it?
And you tell me if I'm answering your question correctly, mm-hmm. but I guess what you're asking is at what point do they lurk? I guess stop learning about it and then start using it. Is that correct?
Will secondary, particularly middle grades and the secondary level, continue and expand on the composition skills with the media? Or are they going to be beat down into that, well, we've got to produce a 10-page paper or a senior year and get that thing out the door? Where's the rest of the media composition in that list that builds on what's happening in elementary?
All of the essential standards are built on revised Bloom's, which you start with that verb, you know, evaluate, create, that sort of thing. I think the standards are fairly vague. I will tell you just a little anecdotal information. I was in Cherokee County yesterday in Murphy. working with Cherokee County's social studies teachers. They were working on developing some tasks to go with the new standards. And what they decided that they wanted to do was incorporate all this 21st century, especially technology competencies, communication competencies that involve technology. And so they put that as a cornerstone of the task that they were doing. Now that's high school. And I think your question is about elementary. I know in the second grade ELA standards, I read a standard, and if I did not know that it was from second grade, I would have guessed it was from eighth or ninth grade, because it was about having students produce some characterization type assignment with technology, and that was in second grade. So I hope that we see that. I don't know if that answers your question, but I hope that we see that.
I'm hoping we see more composition level work in new media than linguistics in the secondary level.
But here in Jackson County, for that to occur, it's going to have to be, it's either going to have to be done class time, because assignments that are coming home for my children who are here in the schools, they're fortunate that we have technology at home, but most of my daughter's classmates do not, and I wonder how in the world they're getting these assignments done. The school has no system or way to implement how to help them with this technology. You know, they may make a statement like, we'll go to the library. Library is 40 minutes from my house, and it's just an interesting situation. If we're going to require more of our students to do, which I think is great, we're also going to have to provide them with the resources in order to do that.
I think that kind of problem solving is happening in our districts. I'll use yesterday as the example. They were wanting to incorporate Moodle with many of their tasks and the threaded discussion. And they said, they were talking about the percentage of their students without internet access or without a computer at home. And their workaround ideas were, of course, before school, making more access, working lunches, where students would have availability at lunches, after school access, that sort. But I do think it's an issue that schools are going to have to work around. Yes?
I was thinking when you said that, schools are losing teachers and they're going to have to figure out how to get teachers to teach these other classes. So I'm curious, along that lines and with what Dee was saying, you've got all of this race to the top funds. Mm-hmm. Where is that going? I mean, how is that going to be spread to districts to help support these new needs that are going to be out there and to provide them with technology so that they can help their students be able to do those homework assignments and things like that?
That's a great question. Each district, when they applied for their share of the Race to the Top funds, wrote in other words, the state did not prescribe. They wrote what they needed for their district. And all of the districts that you serve, their plans are loaded on our wiki, and you can look at those. I guess overarching things you would see in the Western North Carolina counties would be using the money to increase their capacity in their school building as far as wireless technology. Many folks are using professional development to pay subs, to pull teachers out to work on things, to send teachers to different professional development opportunities. But there were some folks hired with Race to the Top funds. However, Race to the Top funds will end in 2014, and the idea is to get that approved, it had to be something sustainable. You had to have a plan for how you'll sustain that initiative after the funding is gone. And so some of the positions hired under that might be things like technology facilitators or instructional coaches, but then the districts had to talk about what will they do when the funding's gone to continue that initiative.
I have just one comment connection. And I know you're just providing a brief overview. When you were on the language arts standards core, I saw quite a bit that kind of you said Bloom's framework was used as a way. I see quite a bit there with analysis and perhaps application and synthesis. I didn't see a whole lot there. And one of your cores was creativity. I didn't see much with creative comprehension and or the evaluative task. I mean, when you start asking for evidence, you really kind of get more into critical comprehension. You're getting at analysis level. Obviously, that's inferencing there. You're having to find evidence and support it with reasoning. But I'm not really seeing that part that really kind of gets at the creative comprehension. It was almost like it was skipped. I mean, even on the slide you had several C's there, collaboration, communication. There wasn't anything mentioned about creativity. Is that how we move? I mean, it seems counterintuitive to what you've already presented.
I think one of the the things that we are really encouraging folks to think about is the standards are what you teach, but then there's how you teach. And so when we think about tasks, where students show proficiency with those standards, we've really got to incorporate the creativity in what task we ask them to do, and allowing choice and creativity.
Because it was like with the writing, you know, the example, I mean, it was just an example, but you know, you kind of gave examples that looked more at different types of writing, and you actually gave an example of non-creative types of writing, and I think that I don't want to see us lose that place. I mean, I walk into schools today, the thing that seems to be most absent is joy and pleasure.
Yes.
And so, we just talk more about standards. I see us in this push to kind of get these little kids to be more like adult learners. Mm-hmm. That concerns me to a certain degree. And what I've seen in regards to kids who don't have the technology at home is they'll just take the recess time, again, a violation of complete work they were unable to complete at home. But there's really not a whole lot of research support that even says that homework is beneficial.
Well, and I think to add on to what Jan was saying, the standards, and we hear this all whenever we mention RBT, revised blooms, the standards were not written according to a taxonomy. They're just a standard. They're not written. We are cautioned to stop, not say that, but make sure that that's clear. However, it's really the instructional tasks is where we want to apply blooms. Because we want the rigor there. Even if, as a teacher, I don't read that standard as something rigorous, my task needs to be rigorous. And so part of the there is a module now, we'll show you in a minute, or we'll show you how to get there, but on the revised blooms technology, taxonomy written by Lauren Anderson, who is an actual student of Bloom, who is really DPI defers every question sort of through him before we say something about blooms, because he'll argue with us that you cannot really get to create in mathematics unless you can discover some, so there's that ongoing debate. So the standards weren't written with blooms in mind. However, what we want to see in the classroom and how we coach teachers is about that. The other piece is, I do know an example in the same, because we've heard this conversation about kids who don't have equal access and equal opportunity to technology. There are some partnerships in some districts that are forming, whereas districts will say, like the power company in some areas is saying, for this remote area, we're willing to put up a tower, and really make those opportunities between the hours of 4 and 6 or 6 and 10 available to students with a password so they could have some online access. There are many school districts now who have used their Race to the Top funding to have one-to-one laptop initiatives. Mm-hmm. Students take those laptops or netbooks home. And Race to the Top really encouraged that, because you can't get to a place where kids are really fully using those technology skills and communicating that way without the hardware and the infrastructure. But a lot of the Race to the Top money went for infrastructure in school districts and for hardware and PD. Those are really the major pieces.
Yes?
Can you address the extended content standards? Are they going away?
No, they're still there. They're still there. And they're actually
following those in the areas of accountability.
Yes.
And they're revising those to align with the Common Core standards, right?
Yes, and okay. You'll see them. They're also posted on our wiki, the extended content standards.
Please don't throw those away.
No.
We worked too hard to get them there.
Right.
Thank you.
They're still there. Okay. Well, I will say about the ACRE website, there's so much there. If you look at our wiki, we've tried to pull the things that teachers might think are the quickest resources, or instead of you having to search. So there's assessment updates on there. There's a link on there to some of those Smarter Balance Consortium assessment released items. I think you might find it interesting to see that instead of like solving the math problem, they might solve it, then they might, if I'm thinking of one that was about probability, where they solve it, then they actually do the spinner several more times, then they create an electronic table, then they write about their problem solving. So it's very different from the kind of assessments we've seen in the past. There's also a link on there to what does computer-assisted assessment look like, and what would it mean in different areas. There's examples of like drag-and-drop assessments, or when you're talking about in science, shadow, where students, it's almost like a video game. They're moving the light to create the shadow, that sort of thing. So it's very different from the kind of assessments that we have been used to in the past. This is something for your toolbox. I don't know how we're doing on time, but the Hunt Institute, which is based in North Carolina, is producing, they have their own channel on YouTube, and they have created these little, they're usually 3 to 11 minutes long, little videos about Common Core. Some of them are big, broad videos. I actually think we have time to show you this little first one. But then there's some that say like third grade math fractions, and it's like 2 and 3 minute snippets that you could use to start. It's really a conversation starter. And these might be helpful for you. On your handout, I also put the Engage New York site. We were working with some teachers the other day, and they said, wait, why is there a resource from New York on there? And the beauty of Common Core is that we can start sharing things across states. We've always worried about how did it align to North Carolina standards. Well, with Common Core for ELA and math, the states that have adopted it, we can really share resources. Both of these video series use the writers of the standards to talk about them. So that's a positive too. So let me see if I can click on that and show you. And then if you want these, the Hunt Institute has all of them on a YouTube website with a little guide.
For decades, we've been debating how to improve schools in the United States. This has been born from a realization that in an ever-changing world, our students need better knowledge and tools to prepare them to compete in the global economy. In math, science, and reading, our students haven't been keeping pace with their most advanced international peers. Persistent and dramatic achievement gaps still exist in our country. College remediation rates are abysmal, and employers say students are unprepared to perform and thrive in the workforce. The need to audaciously confront these issues resulted in a remarkable collaborative effort. The promise of consistent, shared, and rigorous education standards for all students that align with college and work expectations. A new set of ambitious academic standards to set the foundation for even greater student growth and success. These standards, now being implemented,